Beautiful Game now on BBC Two, kicking off a three-part series, and with everything to play for, the entrepreneurs put their money where their passion is, the men who changed football.
Football today is more than just a game. It's a glamorous multi-billion pound industry, attracting top-class players and audiences around the world. But just 20 years ago, football was a national disgrace. This series tells the story of the radical change that would take place in the top clubs of England. Obsessed with football and money, a small handful of entrepreneurs revolutionized the dying game.
Very rough in it, and it seems to excite a lot of roughness in the people who support it, doesn't it?
On the 27th of April 1974, Manchester United fans rioted at Old Trafford. 200 fans were ejected from the ground, and Sir Matt Busby called for calm. This was just the latest outbreak of hooliganism plaguing the English game.
We know that people who wanted to get to the grounds were frightened that they wouldn't come back literally alive. I mean, there were parents were worried about sending their kids. Well, that's not an environment for a sport.
The violence found a breeding ground in the decrepit, decaying stadia. Decades of underinvestment meant that they'd hardly been updated since being built a century ago.
The stadiums were a monument to yesterday's way of entertaining a large and increasingly choosy public.
People used to queue 20, 30 deep and could not get near the toilet.
At the very moment when the future of English football looked hopeless, a new breed of young entrepreneurs emerged, determined to tackle the problems of the game. They were a small group of self-made businessmen whose passion for football led each of them to invest in their club. The key men were Irving Scholar from Tottenham Hotspur, David Dean from Arsenal, and Manchester United's Martin Edwards. What these men were going to achieve was a revolution in English football.
It will be appreciated by the supporters who, for a few...
The new entrepreneurs confronted an older generation of chairmen and shareholders, the local professionals and industrialists.
Archie, I'd like you to give your views of last Saturday's match for the benefit of the directors who were not present.
As you know, he's quite a young lad.
These older men felt it was their civic duty to take care of the local football club, and they enjoyed the social status associated with it.
Right, well, thank you, Archie.
Certainly, I was brought up, and many of my generation were brought up, on the principle that the more privileges you had, the greater your responsibilities were.
The football clubs were seen as amateur sporting institutions, not profitable enterprises.
Directors of my generation, certainly, never dreamt of taking any money from the club.
The entrepreneurs saw this old-fashioned mindset as the cause of football's decline. When they themselves got onto the boards of their clubs, the true extent of the stagnation was revealed.
I remember going into the secretary's office, which was, on the floor was lino with huge holes in it covering floorboards. And you went into certain rooms where people were working and you expected them to have quill pens.
Irving Scholar was a London lad who'd made his money in property development in the southeast. From the age of five, he was a dedicated Tottenham Hotspur fan. In the early 1980s, Rebuilding the old West Stand landed Tottenham £5 million in the red. Scholar saw his chance and took control. One of the first things he did was bring back Argentinian Ozzy Ardiles, the first really successful foreign star of English football.
And now the Spurs side led out by Ozzy Ardiles.
Scholar also took the unusual step of commissioning a national TV advertisement for the club to increase attendances. The ad was a success. But something far more drastic was demanded. Scholar thought of a way to raise millions in one go.
Football fever hit the stock exchange when Tottenham became the first British club to float. The offer was four times oversubscribed and valued the company at just over £9 million.
For Scholar, the flotation was a great success and wiped out the debt.
Football was always complaining it didn't have enough investment. And here we were demonstrating that you could get investment from outside, from the city, if things were commercial.
Ardiles is back in the Spurs midfield. But has he come on too late, I wonder, to influence the way this game is going? We shall see.
Spurs were riding high. Ardiles' return added backbone to the team, and his star quality helped Scholar build the prestige of the club.
Well, talk about instant action from the man who's just come on.
David Dean had made his money as a fruit and sugar trader. He was an Arsenal fan. An investment of £300,000 bought him a substantial stake in the club. At a time when many clubs were facing bankruptcy, it seemed a ridiculously huge sum. Arsenal's chairman thought Dean was crazy. It's dead money, the chairman said.
I was invited to join the board. I became vice chairman in October of 83. And I still had my own business at the time, and I decided that I felt that football was really a sleeping giant and had a long way to go. Particularly after spending time in the States and how the Americans operated their sport, particularly American football and baseball and basketball, I felt we were light years behind and we had so much more to give as an attraction.
David Dean was determined to rebuild the stands, transform the old-fashioned amenities, and provide refreshments, American style. But on the pitch, Arsenal were poorly. In the dying days of manager Terry Neill's reign, the team had lost their touch. Dean had a problem on his hands.
Despite the commercial elements and anything that goes by, it means nothing. It pales into insignificance unless you've got a team that can win matches on a regular basis.
In Manchester, I'm delighted to welcome the greatest football team in the world,
In May 1977, Manchester United got a hero's welcome after winning the FA Cup.
Your chairman, Louis Edwards.
My Lord Mayor, Manchester United are very, very proud to come here and get a reception like this.
Louis Edwards had made his money selling meat pies in shops and at football matches. As his business grew, he took over the club itself. He brought his son Martin onto the board, who became chairman when Louis died in 1980.
I felt as I knew the business. I'd sat there for 10 years listening to all the board meetings and all the rest of it. I'd lived with it at home with my father discussing it and all the rest of it, and I just felt that the time and the moment was right.
Martin Edwards had worked his way up in the family meat business, 10 times the size of the football club.
When I arrived at Manchester United, there was no such thing as sponsorships or match day sponsors and things like that in 1980. They all came afterwards. And even things like budgeting, I mean, I can remember introducing the first budget here when I sat down with the secretary then, or the assistant secretary, who was in charge of the figures, and we sat down and did a budget, which was a very new thing, a very new invention. Congratulations.
The image of football had always been that of the glorious amateur sport. Now, with the advent of city interest, the challenge for football was to cut through the romance and present itself as a professional business.
No wizard rocket scientist is required. So somebody who pays attention and is thoughtful and has experience of managing businesses ought to find it an easy business to manage. It's all on one location. You can see your customers. You can manage the business. It isn't widely diversified. The dynamics of it are pretty simple.
But a football club is not an engineering firm. There is no formula for match success, and injuries play havoc with the budget. When Liverpool player Jim Beglin broke his leg, it ended his career with the reigning champions and wiped thousands off their balance sheet. So a new business philosophy of assessing these high risks spread among the more modern chairmen from all the divisions.
If you budget for failure and you can see that you can get through the season on your bank facilities without getting into a great deal of debt, then you can start off with confidence and you can build from that. And then if your gates go up, that's a bonus. If you get a cup run, oh, that's a bonus. That's additional revenue coming in. So you're going to show an improved position over what you forecast.
The bullish Ken Bates, formerly at Oldham Athletic, had similar views. In 1982, he bought up Chelsea for just £1 and rescued it from bankruptcy.
If you go back to the old days, what used to happen was if you had a bad run, a club sold its best player, paid its debts, which that meant the club was that much weaker, and then they had another bad, and they sold it. So if you like, it was like a whirlpool where you're being sucked down. And my philosophy at Oldham, and it is here as well, is that you have to generate enough money so that irrespective of how badly the team is doing, you're not forced into panic measures by destroying your team. You have to think long term.
To promote the interests of consumers, purchasers and other users in the United Kingdom.
Under Mrs. Thatcher, the privatisation of the country's nationalised industries and enterprises was top of the political agenda. The new chairman applied similar concepts to football.
Suddenly, when businesses were being privatised, the Thatcher government was heavily involved in privatisation of all sorts of sectors. And at that time, when there was something of a business revolution in this country, football arose in the middle of that. And suddenly we were getting British Airways as a company, and we were getting British Steel as a company rather than as huge loss-making government entities. And then football arose at the same time in parallel shape.
Thatcher's philosophy brought hardship and strife to the old industries of Britain. Soaring unemployment meant that many football fans couldn't afford to go to the game. And Thatcher's ideas, adopted by the new chairman, set them in conflict with the traditional attitudes in football.
With the new breed of chairman that was coming through, they, whereas one had this sort of cosy community spirit where people shared in the gate money and shared their gate receipts, people were very much aware, I think probably from their business background, that if they were the creator of the wealth, then they wanted to keep that wealth.
The faded resort of Lytham St Anne's on the Lancashire coast was where the power in national football lay. The Football League was made up of all 92 professional clubs, split into four divisions, and was run in the interests of all the clubs, big and small. The policy of the league was that each club, however small, had one vote, and that all monies were distributed equally. They wanted to stop the dominance of the big clubs. But the new businessmen were unhappy.
When I joined the board in 83, and I went to some of the league meetings, and they were pretty horrific affairs. They were chaotic. And the voting structure was all really upside down. Effectively, there was virtually one club, one vote, which may have been fine, but in the end, it was really the tail wagging the dog all the time. And it was not a formula for progress. In fact, it was totally the opposite. It was anti-progress.
It wasn't just the Football League's antiquated attitude to business that frustrated the new chairman. It was the failure to deal effectively with football's biggest problem, hooliganism. Violence and public disorder at matches had always been part of the experience of football. But by the late 1970s, hooligan gangs organised themselves into firms of hardcore supporters, some infiltrated by the National Front.
You had to run the gauntlet of right-wing propaganda, I'm talking about the far right here, as you walked into the ground. Every black player attracted the most dreadful jungle monkey noises, bananas, all that stuff.
The game came to be associated with violence, racism and danger.
I don't think the media and the press helped football's cause by doing that, glorifying violence. There were bigger headlines over the troubles at a game or a fight that had broken out on the terraces. I would read more about that in the press than I would read about the match coverage.
Attendances fell to 20 million spectators a season. At the time of the 1966 World Cup, it had been 30 million. With gate receipts collapsing, football's income fell even further. The Football League was ineffective, the new chairman felt. They were determined to change things. But within the league, they were outnumbered. Their chance for gaining control was to come over one crucial issue, television rights.
36 cents, opening title.
BBC and ITV had negotiated television rights with the league every few years since the 1960s. The negotiations were focused on match highlights. But live coverage was becoming increasingly important. Only three live games were allowed to be shown. The FA Cup final, the European Cup final, and the England-Scotland match.
Go in studio.
The league had always been unhappy about showing more.
The most powerful single voice in British football today belongs to Alan Hardacre, the secretary of the Football League, which of course is the world's biggest and most successful national football competition.
I have always said that somewhere we're not getting the best out of television. But television live of a football match will not do either the match any good or the other matches being played at the same time. I'm sorry, but
the impact of TV in those days was very, very dramatic. And football was concerned and worried that it would be more people sit at home watching a live game than they would go to the grounds.
When the rights came up for negotiation in 1983, the league agreed to an experiment to show 10 live league games. The first live game was Spurs against Forest on Sunday, 2nd of October.
Good afternoon. Welcome to White Hart Lane. We're making a piece of history here this afternoon, the first Cannon League match to be televised live.
It'll be Nottingham Forest, who will kick off, attacking the goal to our left in red shirts and white shorts. Spurs, of course, in their familiar white.
Everybody was scared because you were stepping into the unknown. Nobody knew. Remember, ITV and BBC had agreed with the Football League at the time that the 10 matches they were going to show live were to be an experiment. Now, you can't judge an experiment until you've tested it.
But the Spurs fans didn't stay home to watch the match on television. They flocked to the ground.
Walsh! Walsh has scored and Forest go into the lead!
Off the pitch, however, tensions were rising. The Football League received £2.6 million from television for the 10 live games. But the new chairman suspected the BBC and ITV of operating a secret cartel, so keeping the price artificially low.
Fuzzy little stride, gets a good cross in, the Stevens! 1-1!
Football was receiving a fraction of its true worth, because there were really only two players in the game, and that was ITV and BBC. And between the two of them, they carved it up.
5 minutes left now, and the score, 1-1, Falco! Oh, whether Archibald got there!
People said it was a cartel between ITV and BBC about football coverage. In a sense, it probably was, but Hardacre and his colleagues wanted it that way. They wanted it split 50-50 down the middle. And they were quite happy with the coverage they were getting, so it wasn't all television. I mean, there was a kind of a mutual understanding between us and the BBC of how much we're going to pay. We didn't one didn't pay too much and the other one paid too low. We sort of had a kind of, what do you think, chaps,
Final whistle! And Spurs have won by 2-1. After Walsh had put...
The experiment with 10 live games was a success for both football and television. In 1985, the television rights were up for renegotiation. And this time, the new chairman were determined that the league should get a better deal for football.
85, it came to a pretty serious negotiation because of the live football involved. and because of what we wanted to do and what the BBC wanted to do. We were still the only two acts in town, bear in mind.
BBC and ITV made a bid for 19 live games plus highlights, offering nearly £4 million per season. On St. Valentine's Day, the bid was presented to the 92 chairman. But not everyone was happy.
The main argument is that the deal that they've negotiated is mad, bad, and sad.
Media mogul Robert Maxwell had rescued both 2nd Division Oxford United and 3rd Division Derby County from bankruptcy in the early 80s. He liked being chairman, but got bored at the games. The fans would chant, "He's fat, he's round, he's never at the ground." But for the other chairman, Maxwell was a man to be listened to. He stood out against the offer.
He felt it was worth about £50 million. And there were gasps in the room. Nobody believed him. They thought he was talking absolute nonsense.
But nonetheless, Maxwell's outburst struck home. The chairman felt they were being fleeced and rejected the offer.
It's only, it seems to me, football that gets his knickers in a twist every time it comes to talk to someone from television. We never have these great debates and arguments about cricket or horse racing or rugby union or anything else.
We're not looking for any dogfights. We want value for money for our game and in the interest of all the clubs that are members.
Robert Maxwell said, "This is ridiculous." He said, I'm a shareholder at Central Television. He said, "I can get you 90 million for this deal." And they all went, "Oh, well done, Robert, you know." And he couldn't get 9p because he had no idea what the value was.
On behalf of all the chairmen, Scholar appointed Margaret Thatcher's favourite advertising agency, Saatchi & Saatchi, to carry out an in-depth analysis of the game.
What we recommended was that there was an opportunity for football to be broadcast in terms of live games as well as highlights, and we valued the current contract at 3 or 4 times its existing value.
It was something that was music to our ears, because we all felt that, but of course, naturally, we didn't really have the experience of actually being able to prove it in an analytical way. But Saatchi & Saatchi gave us the weaponry to be able to fight BBC and ITV.
In spite of the Saatchi report, the chairman had a difficult product to sell. Football was at a low ebb. The hooliganism problem had increased, and even more fans were staying away. Then, on the 13th of March, television broadcast live the worst scenes of rioting ever witnessed at an English ground. At a Luton-Millwall match, the away fans twice invaded the pitch, ripped up the seats, and fought running battles with the police.
It was almost like drawing up battle lines every other Saturday and occasionally in midweek as well, and meant that the whole of this county, its normal policing style was depleted because of one game of football.
I thought, well, what the hell is going on? So I just tried to apply a bit of common sense to the problem and said, right, everybody that goes into the Luton ground will be a member.
David Evans introduced a membership scheme whereby every Luton fan had to have a card to get in, effectively banning away supporters. This outraged the rest of football, and others tried a different tack. Ken Bates at Chelsea tried to introduce electric fences to prevent pitch invasions.
People were still shinning up, and I said, well, hang on. We've now got 9'6" fences up. And somebody at my farm said, why don't you put one of the cow wires on the top? When you're feeding cows in a field, you put a wire across, not a fence, but a wire across, which sends a 6-amp pulse down.
But the council objected to Bates switching on the electric current.
If it's legal, it will be installed for Saturday. If it's illegal, it will not be connected. In the meantime, we wait with great interest to hear from politicians and civil servants, local and from Westminster, what they suggest we do about football hooliganism instead of being utterly negative.
The council stopped Bates. Hooliganism is now on the political agenda. Mrs. Thatcher's attitude to football had always been long-suffering. But now she was forced into action. She summoned the secretary of the Football Association, Ted Croker, to Downing Street to demand answers.
Ted Croker very bravely said, Prime Minister, what I want to ask you is, what are you going to do about your hooligans to get into my football grounds? And she didn't like that.
I wish we could get those responsible, get them before a court and stiff sentences so that they stop anyone else in their tracks from doing this. Now, that's what we want to do, because we want to make it a wonderful game again for people to go and watch. The question is how. And if you can only play a major game with mounted police and police all around the ground, that's not the football we know, and it's not the football we're proud of.
Mrs. Thatcher thought an identity card membership scheme to be the answer.
The football membership scheme, in essence, was about only allowing people into football grounds who were vetted. So it involved inserting a lot of cards into a lot of rather dodgy technology that I personally think would have meant that you'd still be queuing outside at 4:45 when the game was over.
On the 11th of May, an inferno broke out in Bradford City's 70-year-old wooden stand. 56 people died.
We will do everything possible. When you get a disaster, when you get an emergency, everyone but everyone buckles too.
On the same day, a 15-year-old boy was stabbed to death in a riot in Birmingham City. Mrs. Thatcher commissioned Justice Popplewell to investigate crowd safety at sports grounds. Popplewell was shocked by the ancient infrastructure and the drunken and riotous atmosphere at many matches. He recommended increased safety regulations, the introduction of an ID card scheme, and widespread use of closed-circuit television. Just 2 weeks after the fire, English football received yet another blow.
Good evening. The Prime Minister tonight talked of the shame and disgrace that football hooligans at the European Cup match in Brussels have brought on their country. We now know that 42 people, perhaps more, have died and at least 200 have been injured in rioting between Liverpool and Juventus fans before the match began.
Liverpool fans rampaged through the Heysel Stadium. Moments later, a wall collapsed, crushing Italian supporters beneath the masonry. It was the worst ever outbreak of English hooliganism, a day of shame for the British game. In response, the European and international football authorities banned English clubs from international matches for the next 5 years. Attendances fell to an all-time low.
The Bradford fire and the Heysel disaster just added to the overall impression, with constant hooliganism that was occurring at the time, that all wasn't right with football at this period. It made it quite a difficult product, as they say, to sell in television terms.
Since the league chairman had rejected BBC and ITV's offer at the St. Valentine's Day meeting, the negotiations had got nowhere.
Football had made it clear that they weren't finding the terms from BBC and ITV acceptable, and they, as is per their right, they decided they didn't want to sell it for that price.
It all ended up in disaster. The whole negotiations sort of failed, and we said, right, well, that's it. Well, sorry, chaps, we're not going to go beyond that figure. And football, we sort of said, well, we're not going to accept it. So fine. Boom, no football on television for 6 months.
The 85 season started without televised football. A blackout.
The core football fans were frustrated. Football's growing number of sponsors and commercial managers were very concerned because the income had dried up from all those banners around the ground and the advertising that they'd fought so hard to get on the shirts.
The Football League needed television. They caved in.
Soccer will be back on our television screens in a fortnight's time. The television companies and the football authorities came to an agreement this afternoon.
The league agreed to a deal which actually gave them less money per game than before.
I was very disappointed. Football had given in yet again to the demands of television and sold it, albeit on a short-term contract. I think it was for another 2.5 years. They'd sold it too cheaply.
Football is back on television at the start of a year of renewed hope and determination on all sides
to restore the game to health and strength.
As television coverage restarted with the Charlton West Ham match, the new chairman was so dismayed at the league's ineffectiveness that they latched on to the most radical suggestion of the Saatchi report, the formation of a breakaway Super League, incorporating just the top division clubs.
What we wanted to do was to try to be autonomous so that we as a first division could lead from the front on the basis that we could have our own set of rules that applied only to the first division.
Faced with this threat, the league called a crisis meeting at the Post House Hotel, Heathrow. Martin Lange of 3rd Division Brentford came up with a solution, the 10-point plan. The deal was that the big clubs would not break away. In return, they would receive more money and more voting rights.
The big clubs were the wealth creators. They were the ones that TV wanted. They were the one that the sponsors wanted. And I thought it was vital to keep the smaller clubs on side with them.
I think that was a good agreement at that time, and it kept the league together, and that, of course, was the first time we've been instrumental in preventing a breakaway.
While the new entrepreneurs had agreed to stay within the league, they'd effectively gained control. Not only could they dominate the voting, but David Dean and fellow chairman Philip Carter from 1st Division Everton got onto the league's governing body. In 1986, the World Cup finals reignited England's passion for its national game. With memories of the Falklands still fresh, the England-Argentina quarter-final aroused fierce emotions, particularly when Maradona claimed the intervention of the hand of God had helped him score. Football seemed to have turned a corner. Back in England, attendances rose as the hooliganism problem was tackled.
Assistance required north stand near to the main road stand.
2700 mounted.
Closed circuit television and more rigorous policing caught the troublemakers at work.
That had a very significant effect on the reduction of hooliganism. When people thought that they could get caught and imprisoned, I think they thought twice about actually causing problems within the grounds.
Under Mrs. Thatcher, an economic boom swept away the depression of the early 80s. The money poured into football, coming from a new class of well-heeled customers. The entrepreneurs built highly profitable executive boxes, replacing the old terraces.
Okay, let me please allow to show you some of the facilities we've got here at Tottenham. Of course, we've got the girl here looking after us all day long, serving the meal. We've got the crowd control here that we can actually bring the volume so that we feel as if we're part of the terraces, actually.
Fans saw this as a sign that the new chairman were more interested in money-making than working for their loyal supporters. But Scholar was convinced he was working in everyone's interests and pushed his commercial activities a step further.
I was fed up with watching kids walking up and down the high street wearing American football T-shirts, baseball stuff. Why weren't they wearing their own football team's stuff?
Scholar recruited Edward Friedman, a local retailer, to help him with his project. Friedman spotted that the Tottenham name could be exploited as a brand and used to sell a whole range of different merchandise to the customers.
We're trying to give them quality and we're trying to give them design, bearing in mind the whole Tottenham ideas and philosophy. I mean, the Tottenham supporters, the majority of the supporters were quite reasonably well off, and they were prepared to spend the money. They weren't going to argue if they could buy the right product.
Spurs' fashionable clothing and new shopping opportunities were the very beginning of the merchandising revolution that's taken place in football. Raise your glasses and give them a cheer. Hooray for the double and let's... At the start of the 1980s, commercial activities represented just a tiny fraction of a top division club's income. Today, this has risen to almost 40%.
It's a sport and we're in the entertainment business. And we must always remember that the fans come, they spend their money, and we've got to make sure we are as welcoming as possible.
From an old heartthrob to two new heartthrobs, making their debut on Top of the Pops tonight, Glenn and Chris.
The image of English football was substantially improving. As the fans came flooding back, footballers like Glenn Hoddle and Chris Waddle became entertainers, and not just on the pitch. The advent of satellite was to change the landscape of football and television forever. It would bring the big clubs immense wealth and the Super League one step closer. In 1988, the television rights were up for grabs again. The new satellite television company, British Satellite Broadcasting, was determined to win the football rights.
It chose to use sport as a battering ram to develop its businesses. And people were prepared to put up huge sums of money, way beyond what had ever been achieved by terrestrial television.
Suddenly, BSB were in there bidding for the Football League rights. And suddenly, ITV and BBC had to wake up and work out what they were going to do about this.
Whilst in the boardroom, the new pretenders, BSB, were challenging the established order in television. On the pitch, the emerging force of Manchester United was confronting the dominance of Liverpool. Toward the end of the season, the two clubs met at Anfield. In the 64th minute, Liverpool were leading 3-1, but Manchester United had not given up.
And it's deflected. Oh, did that catch it? Liverpool player may have been Gillespie. He's onside. Gordon Strachan with a chance to equalise, and does. What a turner. The 10 men have come back from 3-1 down to 3-3.
The chance of deposing the reigning power lay wide open. In May 1988, the emerging satellite company made its bid for the football television rights. They offered £9 million per season over a period of 10 years. BBC and ITV bid jointly, as always, offering about £2 million less. The Football League readily accepted the higher BSB bid. But then one man came onto the scene determined to break the agreement. Greg Dyke.
BSB had nominally won the football contract from the old Football League. And we thought, well, is there a way of getting this back? So I talked to Trevor East, who was then at Thames Television, and he introduced me to David Dean.
Greg Dyke clearly saw with his vision that here was an industry, here was a sport that could drive an audience.
Dean and Dyke discovered they spoke the same language, and they started to discuss an alternative deal outside the league.
The world had changed, the market had changed, and we needed to be to negotiate straight and be quite aggressive about it, and that's what we did.
Just 9 days after Manchester United had hinted that they, like BSB, might topple the old order, the Kings retained their crown.
Into the path of Aldridge, who just jogs it past the keeper to make it 2-0. Aldridge, Gillespie! Beardsley! And Aldridge! It's 5!
Liverpool, after mauling Nottingham Forest 5-1, won the league title for the 17th time. On the 15th of June, Greg Dyke invited representatives of the Big Five, Arsenal, Spurs, Manchester United, Liverpool and Everton, to a secret lunch at the Belfry restaurant in Knightsbridge, London.
In trooped a whole number of people from ITV, and it was the very, very first time ever that we'd ever met anybody from television other than the negotiators. So this was, for us, quite a special moment. We were actually dealing with the people who made the real decisions.
The point of the meeting was to discuss with the senior clubs, you know, the main clubs, whether they would be agreeable to coming up with ITV
and showing their games live on a Sunday afternoon. And they quite clearly said there was, yes.
But before any serious negotiations took place, Scholar challenged Dyke.
I asked Greg Dyke straight out, is there a cartel?
I was, I think, the first person that Irving had ever met who actually admitted that there'd been a deal between the BBC and ITV.
John Bromley from ITV immediately said, don't answer that, Greg. He said, no, I've been asked a fair question, I'm going to give a fair answer. And he admitted immediately that there was a cartel between BBC and ITV. And I can tell you that at that moment, Greg Dyke effectively won the contract.
Dyke made an offer to buy each club's rights individually for £1 million. The chairman saw that this could be the ideal opportunity to form a breakaway league, supported by the ITV money.
Obviously it was very tempting, but I think also you can't form a league of five clubs. And if we decided, okay, that's great, we'll keep that, then the other clubs in the First Division would never have accepted that. So we knew that you know, there's no way we could ever keep it. But at least what we could do is start talking to other clubs about involving them and securing a better share out.
The Big Five left the restaurant to woo the other major clubs to join their breakaway league.
I suddenly found myself in a situation where the club was being courted by clubs who were wanting to develop what in those days was called a Super League, but by breaking away from the Football League. But I believe that we ought to be able to work out our differences within the ambit of the Football League.
But nonetheless, the clubs found the offer irresistible.
Of course we knew we were breaking the rules in 88, but the rules hadn't worked out our way.
The week after the secret meeting, ITV made public their bid for the TV rights of 10 clubs. The Big Five, along with Newcastle, Nottingham Forest, Sheffield Wednesday, West Ham and Aston Villa. Former rivals BBC and BSB then teamed up and presented a counter bid for all 92 clubs and through the Football League. The crunch came when on the 12th of July, the Football League urged the 92 clubs to accept the BBC-BSB offer and slapped an injunction on the breakaway clubs.
We cannot countenance these clubs negotiating independently with ITV. If ITV wish to discuss a television contract, they must do it through the proper channels, which is through our negotiating committee.
It was a matter for the clubs to decide whether or not they wanted to do the deal directly with us that they'd agreed, or whether they wanted to bring in the whole of the Football League. We left it to the clubs.
Greg Dyke may have thought it was up to the clubs to decide. But the very next day at Old Trafford, ITV came up with a bid for all 92 clubs, negotiating through the proper channels of the Football League. ITV upped their offer to £11 million a season and promised not to destroy the league. On the 8th of August, the clubs cast their final vote.
The Football League clubs have signed a deal to televise league games exclusively on independent television, but only after more arguments about how to divide the money, worth £11 million a season in total. And they also agreed to look into restructuring the league with a possible Premier Division of 10 or 12 clubs.
Although forced to make an offer for the whole Football League, Greg Dyke made a pact with the Big Ten to screen their games most of all. This guaranteed them additional fixed income from sponsorship, advertising and appearance money. But the smaller clubs were left out.
I think it's dog eat dog. Yeah, you could say it's a lack of integrity. You could say it's such a competitive market that anyone will pull any type of string to get one over on a competitor.
The big clubs were happy. They'd successfully negotiated an extremely lucrative television deal, one which represented a 350% increase. And the breakaway Premier Division was now a very real possibility. But the honeymoon wasn't to last.
Good evening. 93 football fans, most if not all Liverpool supporters, have been crushed to death at the FA Cup semi-final at Sheffield Wednesday's Hillsborough Ground.
On the 15th of April 1989, a mass of supporters trying to get into the stadium were allowed to surge into the back of the Leppings Lane stand. This caused massive pressure inside, eventually leading to the death of 96 fans. It was football's darkest hour. Lord Justice Taylor was immediately appointed to investigate the causes of the tragedy.
What Hillsborough really meant in context to professional football clubs was that the clubs, the officials, had to stop acting like ostriches. They had to take their heads out of the sand. They had to make a very positive decision and contribution that this must never happen again, and we have to do everything we can possibly do within our power to ensure that it doesn't happen again.
But no matter how terrible the tragedy, the life of football went on. Hillsborough had caused fixture congestion, so that the league championship decider was delayed till the last game of the season. Liverpool faced Arsenal in a nerve-wracking showdown. Arsenal hadn't won the league since 1971. In order to beat Liverpool, Arsenal had to win by two clear goals. In injury time, the score was 1-0 to Arsenal.
Streaming forward now in surely what will be their last attack. A good ball by Dixon, finding Smith. For Thomas, charging through the midfield! Thomas, it's up for grabs now! Thomas! Right at the end! An unbelievable climax to the league season.
Get as long as I live, was a night of tremendous emotion, and nobody ever thought that we could win. And with the last kick of the season, virtually, and I can remember losing all director's decorum and jumping out of my seat and punching the air and turning around to our chairman, Peter Hillwood, who took his cigar out of his mouth and turned around to me and said, never in any doubt.
If there was any doubt about the popular appeal of football, the massive television audience removed it.
And that's what ITV paid their money for. That was pure theatre. That was drama at the highest level. And in fact, Greg Dyke was at that game. And I remember after the game actually taking him down into the dressing room. And you could see the jubilation, obviously the champagne flowing. And I turned to Greg and I said, well, your money's been well spent.
2 months later, Lord Justice Taylor produced his report on Hillsborough. While he found the main reason for the tragedy to be the failure of police control, he was deeply shocked by the poor conditions so many grounds were still in, and that so little had changed since Popplewell reported on the disasters of 1985. He called for all-seater stadia, the rejection of the proposed membership scheme, and a complete overhaul of the way football was run. It was a damning indictment.
The Taylor Report would force football to get its head out of the sand. He put the blueprint down for the way football must go forward.
The radical ideas and practices of the new entrepreneurs had transformed a handful of the top clubs and revolutionized the power structure within football. So when Taylor published his demands, football was ready to take a great leap forward into the 1990s. Next week, we tell the story of how the new chairman finally break away to form the Premier League, and how Murdoch's Sky Television takes over the reins of power in English football.
And that's at the same time, 9 o'clock next Tuesday on BBC Two.